Good evening. We have a special guest worshiper up here tonight, Pastor John. I'm just kidding. Well, he'll be worshiping. Just he'll be up here with you, with us. Why don't we just begin this time with a word of prayer? If you can join me. Lord, I just thank you for this night that we have to gather as a body, God. I thank you for everyone that's here. Lord, I thank you for the fellowship that we've been able to have. If we were able to make it out for the spaghetti dinner, Lord, thank you for just your provision, God. Thank you for the true sense of family that we can have here. And I just pray that you would continue to foster that unity, God, and that that oneness, Lord, of those that call this place their home. God, that we'd be willing and just so eager to get to know each other and to pour into each other's lives, Lord. And we thank you, God, for this time. May you, Lord, just inhabit our praises like your word says, Lord, that when we worship, that we would have one heart and one mind, one mouth, Lord, and that you would be lifted up tonight. God, we thank you for just the special moments that we can have with you, Lord, in worship as we sing and just give you our attention and our hearts, Lord. So may you have just full reign in this place, God, that you would fill this place with your spirit, that you would speak to us, Lord, that you would prepare us for your word to be just to fall on softened hearts. And God, may you have all your way in this place tonight, and may you get all the glory that you deserve. And we lift this up in Jesus' name. Amen. If you can stand as we sing this first song.
Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from, oh, he is my song. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life, oh, he is my song. For you are
you're never gonna let me down.
is good and that he's never going to let us down. And sometimes I think the things that we see can challenge that thought that God never fails and that he's working on our behalf. But he is. And so as we just begin worship, may you commit your heart to the Lord right now and trust him and give him those things that you're thinking about, those things that seem like he's not working in. And say, Lord, you're never going to let me down. I believe that you are good. So let's sing that together. You're never going to let me down. And thank the Lord for him being good and just for his faithfulness. God is good. And I think that especially right now we have elections, we have just riots, we have people hating on people. And you can see so many things that are not good around, but God is good. And he's working in the midst of the chaos. He brings calm. And so let's praise God for that.
Okay, so that song, you know, God is good, oh, and, you know, you're singing it and you're thinking about it, right? Because it's just like such a deep thing to all of us. So it doesn't matter what happens in your life or where you're at, what state you're in your life. I mean, you find yourself struggling with sin, God is good, oh, okay? You find yourself married to a person you don't like, God is good. Oh, you know, right, little song there with it. But you find yourself in places in life, you know, there's no reason to get mad at God. I mean, death took my wife this summer, but you know, that was death. I'm mad at death because death's the last enemy that will be put under Christ's feet. So, but God is good. He took my wife, but God is good. Oh, like meaning she's in his hands. And then a lot of things happen to us. We break our arms, we break our legs, we break our nose, but God is good. Do you got it? He's always good. And so when we even worship, whatever this next song is, I don't care what you're thinking about looking at your life, you just know that God is good. And let's worship him. He deserves it.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory,
the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Then you lay down. Into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. That you lay down your that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. That you lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
God, we just thank you for all that you've done for us. And may this time, Lord, just truly be that, pouring out our praise, our thanks upon you on what you've done and on who you are. You're so good. You're worthy, Lord. And so even as we sing this next song, you give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. God, we thank you for all that you do.
There's no one that's greater than you.
Lord, we thank you, God, that it's your breath in our lungs. And may we just continue to trust and praise you, God, until there's no more breath in our lungs, Lord. We thank you, Lord, just for who you are. God, I just pray now, Lord, just for our tithes, God, our offerings, Lord. I pray for continued worship, Lord, that our hearts would be given to you, God, above all. And that just the overflow of gratitude that we have to you, God, and our faith would be what drives our giving, Lord. May you just bless those giving tonight. You are a provider, Lord. So we thank you, God, that this is just an act of obedience and of faith, Lord, to trust you with our finances and to trust that you are that you're just our provision in everything, Lord. Even when there's nothing on the table and we don't know where the next thing will come from, God, we know it'll come from you. So, Lord, we thank you for that. And just bless those who are giving tonight, Lord, those that have plenty and those that have little. God, we're all the same. Willing and ready to trust you. In Jesus' name. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise.
Hey, those of you that know my, or you know, knew Maureen and will know her later in heaven, those kind of songs, you know, it's your breath in our lungs. You know, she had the tumors in her lungs, and so, you know, 3.5 years ago, whatever it was, you know, she went and got part of the lung taken out. She probably would have went to the Lord much sooner had she not done that. But it's like, it's not sometimes until that you actually have tumors in your lungs that your breath means something to you, that you're like, you know, with this breath in my lungs that I might praise your name. But I mean, you know, one car accident away, right? That breath is gone from our lungs. And so it's just such a neat thing. So this next song that we're going to sing, just think about the breath in your lungs that God breathed into Adam, made him a living being. And that at your last breath, you're in the presence of God, either for judgment or for salvation. So every breath, let's give these breaths to God right now, okay?
It's not what you have required. You're so-
Lord Jesus, we're getting my sound on right there. And focus us. Focus is Christ. Focus is not us. Not about me, but about Jesus. I'd like to thank Lisa LeDuc and her husband, Chris, there for helping put on, wherever they're at, somewhere around here, for putting on the spaghetti dinner beforehand. So thank you for those that got to participate in having a nice dinner at church before Wednesday night Bible study. Very quickly, Pastor Sean and Alex, they're both on maternity leave. And so he is watching tonight's service, I think. And so anyway, we can all wave to him, but even though the camera's over there on me. But hey, Sean and Alex, welcome. And they had a baby yesterday, and the baby's name is Dea. Okay, the word day, and then A-H, Dea. And so I got a thing for it. So somebody is in the late at night, and it's dark, and they're walking and just waiting for day, and they see the day, and they go, day, ah. There's just that's how you remember her name, okay? So Dea, just trying to help you there. All right, well, a couple little things before I get started also. We're going to teach or learn tonight from the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 7, as we had been looking at that tonight, more specifically about the joys and pitfalls of singleness and a little bit about remarrying. And so we're going to take a look at that, but just to bring you up to date on myself, I was here Sunday, did the crutch thing on Saturday, and I was diagnosed this year, I didn't tell you, but with carpal tunnel syndrome. And then after Maureen died, it went away, it seemed. And so I'm like, oh, that's great. And then when I started using the crutches, it came back with a vengeance. I mean, so bad that shooting pains in every finger. And so I just hadn't used the crutches since Sunday until tonight. So I'm trying to figure out how to do that. So that's one thing. I want to use the crutches for healing because I'm obviously very strong on them, but my hands don't like them. And then the second thing is, and Matt, well, you're sitting there. If you can move that thing out of the way right there, this box right here. Yeah, just push it all the way back for me. Thanks. So we've got that going on. Let's see. So the crutch thing. Second thing is somebody let me borrow one of those knee scooters. You all see those before where somebody's on their knee and they're just kind of scooting along. And so I won't explain the whole scenario, but I actually did fall off of it and fell off really hard and got like a big bruise like that on the area of the surgery. And I got popped a blood vessel on the foot of the surgery. You know, that's the way it goes, right? It has to be right on the surgery, you know. And it hurt as bad as the broken leg. And so just got x-rays today. I'm fine. No, you know. And, of course, I was better by today, but a lot more swelling because now a new injury. So, you know, it's like if it rains, it pours, right? And we all have to get through our things in life. And then I ended up going to CVS on that little scooter and trying to turn around after I checked out. And good thing a couple of brothers from the church were right next to me because I started falling over again because the scooter was falling over. So, yeah, you know, when January comes and I'm walking, I won't even remember any of this. I'll be like, did that really happen? But in the meantime, you know, I was talking to a guy at the orthopedic today, and he had a less break than I. He had a two breaks, but they were just hairline fractures. And he has to keep his foot elevated for 3 months. And he says it's because, like, that I'm going to start learning to walk on November 12th. And so the reason why that is because I had surgery. So I guess surgery is better than having a hairline fracture. So thank God that I, you know, had a bad break because I don't like the bed thing. But let's go ahead and pray. And let's see what the Lord would have to give us on this topic tonight. So let's do that. Lord, we pray that you'd bless everybody who's watching on the Church First Love Facebook page, anybody who's watching on the church website, and also my Facebook page. Bless those that are watching. Lord, bless our church that's here tonight. Bless those that are safely distancing, Lord God, from each other. Not because we told them, just because they know. And Lord, just protect us from any coronaviruses tonight, Lord God. And Lord, we just ask you to just be with the church family. As everybody would listen to this topic and be blessed. And so we just give it all to you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And, you know, I mean, and I will tell you, for the second time, the health department has been here. It was here a few months ago, then it was here Sunday, and they were asking about a wedding that we did last week, and they were asking about our church services and asking a whole bunch of questions, you know, because obviously whatever their concerns are, you know, and so... But if I took a picture of you guys right now, I would say you guys are safely distancing. Even husbands and wives are safely distancing there. And so, you know, my wife and I, when we, and I'm just actually finding my place in my notes, so I'm talking a little bit till I get there. My wife and I, we both, when we were in premarital counseling, there was a long couch, and I sat on that end of the couch, and she sat on that end of the couch. And the pastor said, I have never seen that in all my years of doing counseling. Because obviously you feel comfortable with each other. You're not dependent on one another. And you know, we both had our hard day at work, whatever. And I worked there at the school, at the church there. And so, yeah, it was just a comfort zone. And we didn't have to be just like protecting each other and all over each other at the counseling appointment, like, you know, as if it was scary to talk to a pastor. And so, anyway, why am I saying all that? Because of your distancing tonight. But we learned social distancing at the beginning of our relationship is all I'm saying. All right. So we've got now the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 7, as I had mentioned to you. And the topic, the joys and the pitfalls of what? Of singleness. And now some of you are single. You might not consider yourself single. Maybe you're a widower. Maybe you're never been married. Maybe you are divorced, and you just think, well, I'm divorced, or I'm a widow, or you know, whatever you think about yourself. But if you don't have a spouse, you are, in American terminology, single at the moment. And so all of this will apply to you. Now, if you're married, you know what? This is the scriptures. This is the word of God. And you need to know it because you have friends that are single, okay? So, Lord, Holy Spirit, please anoint what's being said now in Jesus' name. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 7. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 7. Paul the Apostle says, I wish that all men were even as I myself. Now, on a couple of occasions, the Apostle Paul uses that term, I wish, okay? Actually, on three occasions, pretty much. But the other occasion is found in Corinthians. You don't have to look it up. But when he says that I wish you all spoke in tongues. So, number one, Paul's wish is that you all were single. And then he says, and his wish is that you all spoke in tongues. Those are the two times he says that he wishes to the church. And so, on the one purpose is, if you were single and you remained single and you were your whole life was dedicated to God and you were able to, you know, just move about and navigate through life without the cares and concerns of marriage and children, you could do so much. You could have such a great, you know, one-man show impact for God like that, and such a focus. And on the other hand, spiritually, if you are on those long journeys alone, as sometimes he would tell the people to go ahead of him in the ship, and they would go ahead in the ship, and then he actually walked to the location. And that's the part when in the book of Corinthians where he says that it's better to, you know, speak, you know, five words with understanding than, you know, 10,000 words in tongues. Because the Apostle Paul, he spoke 10,000 words in tongues. He just, you know, from what you could tell from the way he wrote, he just spoke in tongues all the way to where he was walking to that next city instead of taking the boat ride. And so he had such an experience. He had such a spirit-filled experience of speaking in tongues and being single for God. And he's like, man, I would wish this on anybody. You know how there's certain things, like say, you know, Nacho Libre. Try to help me with that line there in Nacho Libre. And he's going, you're single, you get to spend the night all night by yourself, and then, you know, going on with the joys of singleness that he hates, and then tells the kids, now go read some books, you know. But, you know, obviously being sarcastic about being unhappily single. Because he liked Ignacio? Oh, thank you. Whatever. Okay, you guys. Oh, God, all these fans of that movie. Yes, it is one of my all-time favorite Christian movies. So, not really Christian, but kind of. All right, so anyway, 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 7, it says, for I wish that all men were even as I myself. And so we're going to get into, what is this? What is this Apostle Paul life? Why would you wish it upon somebody? How could it be so good that it would be good enough for everybody? How could it be so fun and so joyful and so meaningful and so much purpose and so many plans? And, you know, how could life just, because a lot of people are just really tired of life and they're bored with life. And, you know, I mean, I had this one brother from church come to me, you know, Pastor John, I just feel like my life has no impact for God, nothing, no meaning, nothing, you know, not suicidal or anything like that, but just feeling like just kind of purposeless and just going to work and taking care of family and just having nothing resulting that seemed of any value in his life. And I told him, I said, well, number one, are you praying for the people at work? Well, no. I mean, is there anybody that you're witnessing to at work? Well, no. Well, is there, you know, anything that you're, you know, getting involved in somebody's life and caring about them and because they're having heart trouble and went and visited them or, you know, got back to somebody and said, well, how's your mom? Has she gotten over her cancer? I mean, no. I said, well, that's it. I go, your purpose is being at work and being in these people's lives, and you don't have the feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. So how could anybody be happy at work without their shoes on? You know what I'm saying? And so those gospel shoes. And so I wish that you were even as I myself. There is happiness in situations that we would think are not happy situations. Now, he does say, just to alleviate fear from anybody's hearts, that thinking like, well, maybe I need to be single for God. I better get rid of this non-Christian wife next to me. You know, at least she's at church, right? But it says, for each one has his own gift from God. Now, what that means is some people do have an ability to navigate through singleness. Some people have the ability to actually, as this chapter and other chapters discuss, to be able to be celibate, to be able to remain without, you know, being married or jumping around to sexual relationships or just, you know, just really being a pure, what is the word I'm trying to think of, abstinent kind of a person, just to not focus in on sex as part of your life, but to focus in on your, you know, your calling or your ministry. And so this isn't like this huge part of your life. Now, some people think being a spiritual eunuch is meaning that you're absolutely don't desire sex or you never want sex or you're not sexual. And it really doesn't mean that. It means that there are single people that can live for God that just, for some reason or another, they're just never going to get married. And maybe they don't want to be married. Maybe they don't, you know, male or female. Maybe the female had situations in her life and she doesn't like males too much and can't even imagine being married to one. Maybe a man had situations in his life and just, you know, isn't attracted to females or something or whatever. Those kinds of things happen. And then people, the world tells you, well, you must be this or you must be that. And God is saying, well, you know, you must be maybe single. And maybe you're going to do greater works than anybody else because you're going to have so much time. And you're going to learn how to be single. And you're going to learn how to be abstinent. And you're going to learn how to love me. And you're going to learn how to repent if you have to. And you're going to learn how to teach the grace of God to other people. And so the idea of being a eunuch. Now, let me tell you what. We'll get to that verse in a moment. But a eunuch was somebody that was in a king's court. And so, you know, if they were taking care of the maidens, they had to be a eunuch, so that way they wouldn't mess with any of the king's maidens. So there was a reason. Now, I'm not going to explain to you surgically how you could be made into a eunuch, but it is possible. And now how a woman would be a eunuch would be a whole different story. You know, I mean, it would be just a simple dedication to God. But back in those times, it says that people were made eunuchs by force because they were put in a place where they had to be made a eunuch, and then there was those that were born a eunuch because they had some sort of birth defect in their genitalia and their sexual feelings in life and stuff. And so, therefore, rather than it being a bummer and rather than it being like, oh, I'm so messed up and so different than everybody else and I'm this circus case or something or now I'm, you know, the one that isn't and everybody else is a problem or whatever. And so that particular person also that was born, it says born a eunuch, and we're going to get to it, but that person was to dedicate to God. They're born a eunuch or forced a eunuch. And then Jesus said, but then there's also a person that, in Matthew 19, that makes himself a eunuch. Like he just says, this is a choice I'm making. And I feel like God's giving me enough strength to do it. I feel like he's given me the resolve that this is what I want to do. Now, I have talked to single Christians before, and they said they feel like they have the gift of singleness. And then maybe 6 months later, they're going, maybe I don't. But maybe you did. Maybe you did for 6 months, you know, and you enjoyed it, enjoyed the gift for 6 months. But the point is that some people have one type of gift, and you have the gift to be able to ride through storms of singleness with God. And then some people have, as he says here, but each one has his own gift from God. Some people have the gift of marriage, where, you know, the Bible teaches that a person who finds a wife finds a good thing and inherits favor from the Lord. And so, hey, I like the smile of God upon me. I like the favorableness of God in my life. And so that's a gift. It's a gift from the Lord if he gives you a bride. But as we know, as Paul says that it's such a great deal, but some people that have been single for a long time and maybe haven't used it for the Lord, they haven't gone on mission trips every summer, they haven't, you know, used some of their money to really, you know, go on a few Israel trips to really understand the Bible from the Israel point of view. They haven't really gone to church every week, to Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. They're into TV, they're into their own hobbies. They're not a single for God. They're a single Christian, but they're not a single for God. Now, what I mean by that doesn't mean you have to go to all three services to be a single for God, but I'm trying to go as extreme as I can over here to show you that somebody who is on fire for God, they want to be where God's people are. They want to be where non-Christians are to witness. They're all over the place, but they really know what they're doing, and it's all for God. And so so you got the joys and the pitfalls. And so, you know, I think that the joys, if I were to discuss some of that, I only had a very short experience of that, you know, at marrying my wife at 24. And then, of course, who knows how long of an experience I'll have of it, you know, during this period. But there are joys to discover in every state of life that you're in, rather than complaining, oh, do I have to be married to that person? Oh, why do I have to sleep alone every night or whatever, you know? I mean, yes, life can be a bummer if you make it a bummer, for sure. But we have to discover the joys of what has been given to us at the moment and look at it. Even if it's not going to be your lot in life for life, but to look at it is from the Lord. Like, Lord, thank you for this. And so you can find happiness in singleness. It's not like, okay, my other half is gone. Now, believe me, I still hear her, not literally, but like that shouldn't be on that shelf right there, and you should move that out of the way, and this should be clean. It doesn't matter if I'm not here. You need to keep this clean, you know. So I can still hear her. Now, she wasn't all about telling me to keep things clean, by the way. But, you know, it's an easy, accessible statement. But true. But she's not my completeness. You know what? Jesus is my completeness. I am complete in Christ because I'm one spirit with him. And he is Father, Son, Holy Spirit, and he lives in me. And all the power of the Godhead bodily lives in me. So I have a completeness, though, at the same time, had I been a pastor and not known how to raise children and not known about marriage, I might have been incomplete in my understanding to minister to others in certain ways, because I might have had a biblical instruction on how to fly a plane, but having never flown it myself, I might not have the same sympathy or empathy or understanding. And so God's word is always God's word, but when God's word is given with knowledge and understanding, it has greater impact. And so you know, I get to be on both sides of the coin for whatever God's purposes and his good pleasure is. And so if a single person were getting up here and giving testimonies tonight, and, you know, if I'm just looking at John and Elizabeth right there, you know, they've been single for a long time. Pastor Sean was single for a long time. And people find themselves in single situations, even if they're still married or whatever, but for a long time, separations, all that kind of stuff. And so it's for a long time. And so what can it do? It can either drag you down, and it can be a snare and like a snag in a sweater on your life. Or, you know, like that whole, it sounds like a silly statement, but if life gives you lemons, right, what do? No, you eat them. No. Yeah, you make lemonade, right? You make something good out of it. Okay, just had to say that. Okay. So, there are drawbacks. There are disadvantages to being single because, you know, you don't have the easily accessibility of snuggling up. You just have to wait until you come to church to get that really big hug or whatever, you know? So there's some disadvantages in different ways. There's always downsides to everything in life. But if we focus in on the downsides, then we're focusing in on the negative, and we're not seeing why and what God is doing, the positives. And so singleness was good, Paul was saying, and I wish it upon everybody, but I know it's not really acceptable for all, and I know it won't really work for all. Just like when he said, I wish you all spoke in tongues, but then he said, do all speak in tongues? And the answer was, of course, no. I wish everybody did because it's the most awesome thing, but everybody doesn't. And I wish you're all single, but not everybody is going to necessarily be married. Now, the Apostle Paul, let me explain to you about him being single. In order to be part of the religious order of the Pharisees and such, there was an understanding that you would be married. Now, who knows? I mean, you know, some people think maybe he was widowed or such. But he doesn't talk about it. And it is strange that he doesn't talk about a wife having died when that could be so helpful. But sometimes he does speak of himself in the third person, like when he died. When he died, when they stoned him to death, and he said, such a one went to the third heaven, and he saw things that aren't lawful to speak about on earth. He spoke of himself, but didn't boast of himself in that. And so when you look at his teachings on marriage and remarriage, and if a spouse has a spouse that dies, and what they should do, but only marry in the Lord, and gives all these instructions in 1 Corinthians chapter 7 that I'm not even fully covering at the moment. And when he says all these things, it seems like he is a pastor that's saying things from understanding, like not just off the cuff, and not just, you know, well, this is what the Bible says, but he knew and he understood things. And so somewhere along the line, he had to have been married, even if he was divorced, and we just don't know what it was. Now, in verse 8, it says in verses 8 and 9, and we're going to go back to verse 8 and 9 in a little while as well, of 1 Corinthians chapter 7. It says, but I say to the unmarried and to the widows. Now, there's a lot of categories of singleness, as I said. Here, widows. Here, unmarried. Who falls into the category of unmarried, right? And then it says, it is good for them if they remain even as I am. Now, in the chapter, he talks about the coming of the Lord. And in his mind, the coming of the Lord is happening pretty quickly. And so it's better to remain single because you don't have to focus in on marriage and get so much done because the Lord is at hand. He's coming. And so Paul's thinking this, and you can see that from his writing. It says, but if they cannot exercise self-control, let them marry. And I already taught on that a couple weeks ago. He says, for it is better for them to marry than to burn with passion. But I do want to talk about the single burning with passion in a moment. So, Paul talking about different kinds of singles, Paul being single himself, falling into that category, and yet he's not a single for self, he's a single for God. He talks in Scripture, in Corinthians, about like other disciples taking along a believing wife, like Peter brought a believing wife. And he says, doesn't everybody have that privilege? He says, but I haven't taken any of these privileges to myself. And so when it came to those that were in the ministry, if you took a believing wife on your mission trip, she would have to have a fundraiser too. She would have to have all the traveling tickets and documents too. And then if you had kids, you're dragging them all along as well. And so Paul, in his back and forth teachings on this, really showed the superiority of singleness when it came to serving God. Now, does that make one Christian, a single Christian, better than a, you know, married Christian? No. Because the married Christian then would reflect Christ in the church, would reflect what a good marriage is with Jesus, you know, at the center. And so when people would come to a church and visit a church and they see other married couples and they are working on their marriage and they go, oh, we'll come to the married couples fellowship, you know, at the Christensen's home. And it was actually at church, this last one, which was Saturday night. But you would... It forms ministries in the church. And then all of a sudden we have a children's ministry because we have parents. I understand it sometimes as a reflection of singles as well. But, you know, in the general sense, parents. And so then the church becomes a part of the community with married couples, with children. And so being married creates community, creates family, creates, you know, where people can come and have Thanksgiving at your house. And this is one of the things that my wife and I would do each year, is we'd always have just different people who, for some reason, their spouse was out of town, or they were just, you know, single, or whatever. And we'd have one or two people, for whatever reason of their being alone at Thanksgiving, over to our house each year. And so it wasn't just, well, this is our family thing, and these people will intrude upon it, and they're just going to ruin our whole atmosphere that we always have. And, you know, it wasn't like that. It was, you know, and you know, it takes two to tango, right? And so this was not just my wife. And it was, this was not a nice, and believe me, and my wife will tell you, though she was a strong woman, I was never a passive husband. Except, as every husband, there are times where you do want to keep peace. You just know when to go, yeah, that's fine, honey. But the point is you know, in doing these things, we were both in agreement. We both wanted to serve the Lord. We were both singles for the Lord first, and then God brought us together as people that understood that this was what was most important. And so we were almost, but not really, but almost two singles serving the Lord as a married couple. And so it was kind of a double dose, you know, of oneness. And so, you know, God can do great things. Just finding some better place in the notes. Okay, Acts chapter 26, verse 29. Acts chapter 26, verse 29. It says, and Paul said, I would to God that not only you, but also all who hear me today might become both almost and altogether such as I am, except for these chains. Now, Paul was before a crowd of people and witnessing, but he is talking about the wonderful joys of being a Christian, you know? And he's talking to this whole crowd of people and said, I wish to God that everybody could be just like I am right now, except not having these chains on, of course. And so, what a funny thing, huh? You're in chains and you're telling everybody, I wish that you could all be like me right now. Oh, wait, except for these chains. So, meaning that there are the pitfalls that go along with serving the Lord, could even go along with singleness. You know, my son last night, Elijah, those of you that follow him, you know, he got beat up last night by some BLM protesters that were all robbing the Walmart. And, you know, if you watched it on TV last night in Philadelphia, and about 1,000 of them, you know, just annihilating everything. And not that all BLM protesters, you know, because we all know many of them throughout, you know, have done that, but that's what's been happening as of late, right, in different places. And so they beat up my son, and, you know, huge fat lip here. And so, you know, it'd be like my son saying, oh, man, this is such a neat way to live, and, man, go out there and filming all these things that are going on and get your stuff on, you know, TV, and I wish you guys could all do this. And then you see this big, huge, fat lip, and you're like, well, how did you get that? Maybe not. Maybe I don't want to do that, you know. Like, everybody's lives seem a little romantic to us. You know what I mean? We romanticize somebody else's life. Oh, Pastor John. Oh, and such a great marriage and everything. And then it's like, yeah, but, you know, at 56, do you want your wife to be dead? You know what I mean? Like everybody has a different story. And so we do need to be thankful for where we're at and what we have when we have it. And so Paul's life was no doubt awesome for God. And I wish you guys all had that same awesomeness. Now, in all things in life, like say for instance, now once this, I mean, if President Trump wins, the coronavirus will pretty much be over, okay? Other side wins, it's going to go on for years. That's just the way I believe it's going to happen, okay? But let's just say, you know, there are pros and cons with voting, right? You're going to have a mask on for the next 2 years if you vote one way. You're going to get your mask off in the next couple months if you vote another way, okay? So we look at this and we go, life has an effect of how do I choose? I don't like this, I don't like that. This stacks up against that. And so we're trying to make a choice of which is better. And even Paul one time said, you know, I'm between the two. To depart and to be with Christ is far better, but to stay here is more needful for you. And so we're always caught up in something looks a little bit better. Somebody else's life looks a little bit better. But then when you evaluate it and you look at it and you go, well, okay, we have a church, okay? After the coronavirus, and actually all I was trying to say is this. I wasn't trying to talk about voting. It just fit in, okay? But y'all better be voting at least, right? And then, so then we've got, when everybody comes back to church, we have normal, maybe 2 Sundays a month, pretty full, but even though things are going to change and maybe things are going to be different, maybe things are going to be better, I don't know. But, you know, we just have to have a positive attitude, right? But you could look at people say, oh, I'm going to go to this big church over here and like, oh, it's so awesome and the teaching is so much better and the this and that is so, and the children's ministry is so much better. And then people, then somebody else is like, oh, no, but I have this church over here and but I like it like this. And so then if you were to compare a small and large church, you would say there are pros and cons, right? There's cons with everybody knowing you, and yet there's pros with it. There's cons with maybe not knowing people if you're just kind of an in and out person, and then there's pros with maybe, yeah, you get some awesome teaching. But with all of that, when it comes to being married and being single, we also are stacking the things up as far as what's best for me. You know, what does God have for me? In this chapter, it said that if you're married, it says don't try to be single. Like, he actually says that to the married, don't try to be single. You know, just, then he says to the married, he says, but if you are married, live as though you are single. It's kind of, there's a couple of different things in this chapter that, you know, kind of look like they contradict each other. So it's good to be married. It's better to be married sometimes, it says in this chapter. But try to live as you're single because, you know what, if you're so caught up in the God of marriage, and when I say the God of marriage, do you know some people make their marriage out of a God? Like if you were a Mormon, and they're not fully taught this anymore, even though it's a big part of their doctrine, but that you're going to be a God of your own planet if you're a man, and your wife's going to bear spirit children, and so therefore, you know, family is the most important thing, and your marriage is the most important thing. It's not that all the marriages in Utah are great marriages, but the point is that some people exalt marriage, and sometimes churches, Christian churches, exalt marriage too, to the point of it's a god, or people promote education as if it's a god, right? People just really overemphasize certain things, and but we're not overemphasizing marriage. We're emphasizing the kingdom of God. We're emphasizing let's be on fire for the Lord together, and don't you slow me down, wife or husband or whatever, and you know I'm gonna go full speed ahead for Jesus, and. You know, and you either come with me or you're going to be left in the dust, even though I'm going to still love you, you know. And this is something that in our day and age, we don't understand because like, no, your marriage, it's God, marriage, and then family. No, it's God, marriage, God, family, God in everything, God always first, you know. And so with that, you know, the whole idea of, don't seek to be loose from a marriage because, oh, I'm married to this non-Christian or I'm married to this real boring Christian or whatever. Don't seek to be loose. And if you are not married, you know, don't necessarily seek a marriage. And in fact, at the end of the chapter, he says that whatever state that you find yourself in, especially as a new believer, and at this particular time, Paul was saying, try to remain in that state that God called you in, instead of just trying to figure out your life. You know how everybody has to figure out their life by Friday? Well, should I go to this college? Well, should I marry this person? It's like, you know what? You don't have to know all of that by Friday. You just need to know right now that you need to seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. And so, and I'll tell you what, as we know, marriage and singleness both have storms of their own. In a marriage, you know, you put two people together, what do you have? No, not a baby. You have a fight. Because men and women are so different that it just creates a fight. But those fights, the pecking order, all of that is good for finding out who is, you know, Christ is the head of the man, the man's the head of the wife, and the wife, you know, respects her husband and then, you know, runs the family, the keeper of the home. Even though she might even be working full-time. I'll tell you what, all these women that work full-time and they come home, their husband does a little bit, but they're still doing all the laundry. I'm telling you, even in the non-Christian homes that are, you know, looking at things pridefully like, you know, well, we believe in equality and women's live and all this stuff. And I'll tell you what, it's still the man expecting the woman to do it all. And all those homes, believe me, that's, you know, when I say all, I mean, I know enough of it to say that it's a big percentage. You know, we all have to make up our own percentages, right, from the world that we live in and the people we know. But Our eyes are on Jesus and not on the storms of marriage. Our eyes are on Jesus and not on the storms of singleness. And sometimes, as a married couple, you can be so busy running your family and going to work and putting food on the table and making sure you got new beds and this and that, that everything has to be functioning and happy and working and everybody's healthy, and that all of a sudden, you know, you didn't have devotions a couple of days in a row. You know, or you're a single person and your whole thought is like, man, I'm just waking up and, you know, getting up at 5 first 2 hours before I leave for work at 7 is, you know, even if I don't shower, let's just say this pretty stinky person there, but, you know, I'm having devotions, time with God. And so maybe less distractions and more focus. But both of them have their own blessings, and not one should feel jealous of the other. It's like Matt and Mindy here just got married. I'm not jealous. I'm happy for you guys. You know, that's your blessing. We all have our own blessing at our own times. And Paul found the ability to serve God better as a single man, with that being his gift. And as the scriptures teach, that if you have a gift, you got to use it. And you're a part of the body. Whether you're a married part of the body or a single part of the body, you got to use it for the Lord. And so if you are a single, and in whatever form or fashion that you would be a single, and not everybody that is sitting alone is a single, but how many of you consider yourself a single in here tonight? Raise your hand. Okay, keep it up. Don't let it down. Okay? Okay, the rest of you may go now. Because you're going, this message is boring, Pastor John. But okay, so all of you that are singles, you know, you have an opportunity to hear from God tonight. You have an opportunity to say, I want to use this my utmost for his highest. I want to use this to the utmost. We all should be doing our most for the Lord, but I can tell you single people can do the best of the most for the Lord if they apply themselves. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 29 to 35. Let's get there. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 29 to 35. Okay, it says, but this I say, brethren, from First Love Calvary Chapel in Whittier, the time is short, you guys, you Whittier people, so that from now on, even those First Love Calvary Chapelites who have wives should be as though they had none. Okay, all you married guys, whether your wife's here or not, stand up right now. Married guys, stand up. Keep standing, okay? Now, doesn't mean you should go chasing some nun. Okay, it says be as though you had none, N-O-N-E. Okay? And not trying to be silly. Oh, I'm trying to be silly. Yes, okay. So be as though you had none. And that's a big chore. It's like your wife's going to feel put off. I know one wife that used to be jealous of her husband's ministry. He was a pastor. Because he puts all his time into the ministry and not me. And she used to, you know, they would have their talks about that. And it, you know, would hurt her. Guys, figure out how you can please God and love your wife as Christ loved the church, and yet the opposite flip side of the coin, love your wife as Christ loved the church, and then turn the coin around. Now, be single for Jesus. Be as though you had none. That's what it says right there, okay? I don't want you to forget it. You have two sides of who you are in Christ, in marriage. Okay, you can be seated. Thank you for doing that for me. Okay? So it says that those who had wives should be as though they have none. Those who weep as though they did not weep. Those who rejoice as though they did not rejoice. Those who buy as though they did not possess. Verse 31, and those who use this world is not misusing it, for the form of this world is passing away. In other words, our whole life in this world needs to be light-handed. Light-handed on our wife, light-handed on the very world that we live in, because there's such a bigger purpose and cause than just marriage and things. Okay? Verse 32, it says, but I want you to be without care. I don't want you to be overburdened by life's concerns. He who is unmarried, it says he cares for the things of the Lord, how he may please the Lord. But he who is married, he cares about the things of the world and how he may please his wife. And you know what? And I understand that. Because I would do anything almost for my wife and give her almost anything. And she knew that she hardly ever asked me for anything because she knew that I would figure out a way and always say yes. So she actually restrained herself and just would really try to keep from asking me for, you know, things where a lot of wives are, oh, but we need this and you should get that and we got to have this. And my wife just didn't do that because she just knew that I was just like that, you know, just wanting to do anything I could for her. And so you do. You think of that when you're married, how you might please your wife. Verse 34, it says, there is a difference between a wife and a virgin. And, you know, I'll study that a little bit better maybe next week. But the point is there are those that are vowed to be married or those that have never been married. And the way that they would be able to live their life to God. And so it says, the unmarried woman cares about the things of the Lord. So it's just repeating it with man and woman. And that she may be holy both in body and in spirit. But she who is married cares about the things of the world. Yeah, cares about the things of the world, how she may please her husband. And this I say, verse 35, for your own profit, not that I may put a leash on you. I'm not trying to, you know, force you to say, I wish you were like this and you need to be like this. You know, because there's a lot of spiritual manipulation that happens from churches and pastors. And Paul was saying, I'm not doing that. I'm just trying to go back and forth and show you the pros and cons. I'm not trying to put a leash on you, but for what is proper, and that you may serve the Lord without distraction, and that you might recognize it as a married couple. As a married couple, no, put the Lord first. As a single, put the Lord first, and put distractions aside as best as possible. And I'm thankful for all members of the church. Whether they're single or married, they are the backbone. You are the Christian community. And one of the beautiful things that he does for single people is if their parents have died and they have no sisters or brothers that live within the state and they never had children, is he puts them in a church family and those church people say, hey, why don't you come to my house for Thanksgiving? Because it says in Psalm 68, verse 6, it says, God sets the solitary, unmarried, single people of the church in families. Read it. Psalm 68, verse 6. I added a few words there, but that's the Amplified version, right? John Schaefer Amplified version. God sets a solitary First Love Calvary Chapel single Christians into families. He brings out those who are bound in prosperity. Like, God just works in people's lives. Proverbs 18, verse 1. And I know because I'm in this chair, I can be going like this and looking over there where Rick is and then going like this. And so if you guys feel left out, I'm not looking at you guys during the message. And so sorry, everybody over here. Okay. So Proverbs 18, verse 1, it says, a man who isolates himself seeks his own desire, and he rages against all wise judgment. Okay, check that one out. A man who isolates himself. Here's what I have to say about singleness, and my view is still the same. If you are a person who can't have roommates because you, you know, maybe make a lot of noises or talk to yourself walking through rooms or whatever, you know, just habits you've learned, I believe that you should, you know, there's got to be somebody somewhere along the line in the church that you can trust, and that whether you're taking care of a foster child or you're letting somebody have free housing for 3 months or you're inviting somebody to, you know, rent a room with you and see how it works. Let's try this for 6 months and see if it works or whatever. I think that the whole idea of isolating yourself as a single person is just wrong as a Christian. It means that you're maybe either selfish or you just can't get along with people. And I will say, though, if you can't get along with people, it probably is best that you don't have roommates there, you know, because that would be horrible if you're screaming at your roommate. And yes, you probably need a lot more church than you're getting. But the point is that in this, where it says a man who isolates himself seeks his own desire, like, What are you doing? Well, it's like, no, I'll go to church when I want. I'll get up when I want. I'll be late when I want. I'll, you know, and that's not really it with singleness. Singleness should make you more diligent, more on top of things. It's like, yeah, the mom that's trying to find the kid's shoe and they get into church 15 minutes late because they're all screaming at each other because they couldn't find the shoe. I mean, they have distractions. And that's understandable that they came 15 minutes late. But for you, single person, it's never understandable. You like that as a pastor? You know, that's the way I get you to get here on time, right? Now watch me. I'm going to be late next week. Okay. So, and you know, there's one scripture. It's like, you know, when you get on your high horse, right? Proverbs 29, verse 21. And it's really only the King James and New King James and a couple other versions that word it this way. I've looked it up in the Greek before, and it is kind of confusing because it's worded negatively and positively, this particular verse. But I like the positive take on it. When you look up the words and everything, you can see why it can go either way. And you're not understanding what I'm saying unless you look at the verse in other translations, okay? But basically it's saying that you can have a servant. And today we don't really, we hire people, but we don't have servants. And we don't have slaves and that kind of thing. But back then, you know, people would hire servants, hire slaves, all that kind of stuff. And it says that this person, because you were pampering him and taking care of him, that he becomes a son in the end. Now, one other translations translate it negatively, that he's going to take all that you have or whatever, you know. But the idea is that there are people that aren't even your family that could become your family, that you've put something into them. So even though you're single, you can have all kinds of love. There can be fondness. There can be affection. There can be love. And people, you know, I understand there are some people, because of molestation or rape or all those kinds of things, don't touch me. Or they were raised in a house where everybody was just so, so white or something. That's like nobody touches anybody. You know, where you have some other house where everybody's all kissy and huggy and whatever. You know, so the point is that sometimes at church we have to drop our upbringing and we have to drop our likes and dislikes and we just need to throw out a couple of hugs or kisses or something. And you do it sometimes not even for you, because you're like, I'm fine. I'm fine with my wife. I'm fine with my kids giving me a kiss out the door. I don't need anybody else. But that's kind of selfish when, you know, there's some people that could really using you to love upon them and you could be a blessing. And what if you didn't bring anybody else to Christ for the rest of your life, but you just loved on people for the rest of your life? I mean, that would be some sort of reward right there, right? And not saying that, you know, you should give up one to the other. But one of the things I wanted to say about singleness is that sometimes single people develop eccentricities of certain things. Like, we took this one guy out to lunch before. And, you know, we're out there and he's taking the napkins and getting more napkins and squishing his potatoes down, trying to get every ounce of oil. It was taking a really long time to get all the oil into the napkins, you know, and pushing his hands on it. And you're looking and you're going, what is up with that guy? There's no wife in the world that would ever let that guy do that, you know, in a restaurant, you know. Or I'll be careful on this one, but somebody else that was standing there in the front desk area and talking to myself and somebody else a long time ago, and just picking their earwax the whole time. You're like, well, what is up with that guy? You know? And a wife would never let him get away with that. You know? And so there are just some eccentricities that you have to be able to catch yourself so you're not a bad witness and so you don't come off weird. You know? And sometimes it's a good friend that lives with you that will tell you some of those things. Going, do you know that you always do this? And like, how dare you tell me I always do that? Well, you know what? I'll tell you something. Do you ever have things in your life where, like, you don't really want to become like something, even though you love your parents to death, but there's something about your parent you don't want to become like? You ever heard that? Okay? So I remember when I was a kid and seeing my dad laugh like he would bend his back and go, you know, like bend it. And I'm thinking, I am never going to laugh like that. And then all of a sudden in my young adult years, it was like the first time I found myself and I was swinging my backpack. I'm going, no, you know, didn't want that to be, you know. And I think that, you know, there are things that even my, or a wife might say, but and my wife would say that, you know, maybe this particular thing you don't want to become like when you're older. So if you don't catch it now, you're going to do that all the time. And there's such good things with somebody being able to tell you something rather than just being a single person with eccentricities that nobody tells you anything so you don't make any changes. So just wanted to throw all of those things out there for a moment, okay? Now, the scripture I was telling you about earlier that was in the book of Matthew, and based upon that fact that each one has their own gift, and so that way you could have that gift of singleness, is in Matthew chapter 19, verses 11 and 12, okay? Matthew chapter 19, it's the words of Jesus, and he's talking about singleness. Now, we know that Jesus, our Savior, was never married, and no, not true, you know, that he had nothing going there with Mary Magdalene. That's, you know, people can create all kinds of, you know, false narratives. But he was single, and he was just, that was what God chose to do. God chose to send his son, and for one purpose, and it wasn't for marriage, but it was for all marriages and for all singles. And so in Matthew chapter 19, verse 11, it says, But he said to them, all cannot accept the saying, but only those to whom it has been given. Like only to those that it's a gift. Those are the ones that are really going to understand this. It's going to bear witness in their heart for them. But not everybody is supposed to accept it. He says, for there are eunuchs who are born thus from their mother's wombs. Maybe they're born with double genitalia or male-female genitalia. Maybe who knows what. You know, some sort of birth defect. But from their mother's wombs, they grew up and they never had sexual desire, whatever. And all the way from birth defect to that. And so it's saying that for some reason there are people like that. He says, and there are eunuchs who are made eunuchs by men, which we don't, at least in the United States, we don't do. Maybe other countries they castrate people, but we don't do that. It says, and there are eunuchs who have made themselves eunuchs for the kingdom of heaven's sake. Now, let me explain something to you. The first thing that those of you that were raised Catholic think of, like, oh, yeah, the priests, they're not allowed to get married. That's not what this is teaching. Do you know that the Bible actually says regarding a pastor, he's supposed to recognize that anybody who teaches the forbidding of marriage, it's false doctrine. And so if I were to say anybody who wants to be a pastor here at First Love Calvary Chapel has to be single, so that way you're focused on the Lord, and it was forced singleness for ministry, even though they say it's not forced because the person already took a vow and gave themselves to God and gave their singleness to God or whatever, but really nobody could go in the ministry like that and to that degree unless they're single, so it is forced if you really look at it, you know, from, you know, the way everybody else would look at it. And so the point is that you'd go, well, are they doing the right thing? Because, well, you know, you see a lot of the results of that over the years, and you're going, maybe it wasn't the right thing, right? And so the point is it had to have been a gift from God. It had to have been the Lord really calling a person to do that. And it had to be voluntary and acceptable to them and to God. It wasn't some church-created doctrine, because marriage is the church doctrine. And then Jesus says, they made themselves eunuchs for the kingdom of God's sake. He who is able to accept it, let him accept it. So here it all is. He just kind of lays it out. And, you know, hey, maybe this is you, Jesus said. So some man's born with low T. Maybe later on he has diabetes. And those of you that study diseases and know people know that there's certain things that create ED in men and things like that. And so people get things and they're not functionable sexually anymore, even though their mind still is. But they could use that lack of functionality for God. And they could get their mind in line with what their body's doing, you know. And then all the other things I was mentioning at the very beginning, as far as not regular attraction or all these kind of things, even though it might be sound like, oh, but that's not fair, and it's a life of suffering, and you're single, and you just don't get to have relations. But, you know, isn't all of life a life of suffering? You know what I mean? And if you could give your suffering over to God and just go, you know what, this is a struggle, being single and feeling like this or feeling like that, and yet it's better that I give it to God and let God use it. Even if I'm lonely, it's better I give my loneliness to God and let God use it, because life is short. You know how people say live life to the fullest because it's short? I say live life for God because life is short. And Jesus is coming. Live it for Christ. And so use your singleness for God. And in the Bible, they think Daniel might have been a eunuch. The Ethiopian eunuch that was under Candace the queen, you know, he got saved through reading Isaiah, and who was sitting next to him, and that Philip was sitting next to him in the chariot. So a choice of singleness, a choice of trying to commit these difficult issues of life, of sexuality and everything like that, to the Lord. But then he says in the whole chapter, but if you cannot do that, or if you don't want to do that, and you don't choose that, or you don't have that gift, or you don't even have self-control in your life sexually, he says, then you really need to look toward marriage, so that way you're not living a life of falling and getting up and falling and getting up and repenting of this and repenting of that and just having sexual torment your whole life. That it's better to marry. And then there's other things like the days of Noah. You know, people were marrying, but yet they were forsaking God. And other times in the Bible, they were marrying pagan women. And yet they're still going to, you know, to the Sabbath day and yet marrying pagan women. And so people mix their own ideas of what they think it is to marry women or not and follow God. But there's a lot of scriptures on this that if a person was wanting to please God in it, there's a lot, not only that the Word says and that Paul says, but that you could see and the Holy Spirit could give to you for your own life. Like, I can't say it all in one night, but the Holy Spirit, when you go to bed tonight, he can cause you to dream about it. Verse 8 of 1 Corinthians chapter 7, it says, "But I say to the unmarried and to the widows, it's good for them if they remain even as I, but if they cannot exercise self-control, then let them marry, for it is better married than to burn with passion." And the idea of burning with passion means to burn with lust, and it means that someone cannot control their sexual desire. And I mean, everybody can to some degree. If you give somebody $1 million and you say, control your sexual desire for 1 year, and you have this $1 million free and clear, I mean, whether, you know, you put a tape over your mouth or whatever, you would figure out how to, do it. Because people are motivated by money. People are motivated by fear of getting AIDS or fear of getting a venereal disease. And people are motivated by a lot of things. People are motivated by not getting emphysema. So you put the right motivation in a person's life, and that's what you got to ask the Lord for. Lord, if I'm going to do this, you got to put the right motivation because I have all these desires. But God has given you an option, even as a single, of being able to live right with God, and even if that means getting married, and that you're not doomed in your singleness or in your marriedness. But if you do blow it in some way, which Christians do, and their relationship with God has maybe got some log jams and tainted in some way, or your marriage has been affected, or your singleness is, you know, your witness has been blown, you go to that throne room of grace. You confess. You lay it down at his feet. You trust in the blood of Jesus Christ. You talk about God. You talk to God about your life every step of the way and every ounce of feeling and thought and emotion and sexual feelings and everything that you go through. You just don't hide behind a fig leaf. Oh, you know, God, you can't see me naked, you know. Because the Bible says if we do have any sins, we have an advocate in 1 John chapter 1, which is Jesus Christ the righteous. And, you know, that's in verse, let's see, "My little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin. If anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous." That whole section of scripture, verses 8 through, through 10 and then 1 and 2. Just awesome section of scripture to, if you have problems and you fall and you have some issues in your life, you have to learn to go to the advocate. He's your defense attorney. And we all love that song, you know, "Every Hour I Need You," right? And so when temptation comes your way, when I cannot stand, I fall on you. Lord, I need you. Every hour I need you. You are my defense. You are my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Anybody relate to that? We need God, don't we? And so he provides ways for a tormented life sexually to be able to walk with him, and that the Lord does understand these things. And he does give answers in the Bible, and his Holy Spirit does give individual answers as well as you enter into the world of singleness or the world of marriage. And if you happen to be a single person, and I got to close it pretty closely on this one, but if you happen to be a single person because your spouse died, and that's what it says there in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 10 and 11, it says, Now to the married I command, not I, but the Lord, a wife is..." Oh, let's see. Okay. Ooh, that was another part. Okay, let me jump because I'm missing half my notes. Okay, go to that verse. Okay, there it is. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 39 and 40. It says that a wife is bound by law as long as her husband lives. But if her husband dies, she is at liberty to be married to whom she wishes, only a Christian marriage, it says right there. See that? It says, but she is happier if she remains as she is, according to my judgment, and I think I also have the Spirit of God. So that's Paul talking, but he's saying that, you know, remarriage for some in singleness, but only in the Lord. You got to be not unequally yoked together just because you want love, just because you want to be accepted, just because you're trying to find a place in this life and a partner in marriage. It really is better to fast and to pray and to say, Lord, help me, you know, bring my Eve or my Adam my way, you know, and help me to know. And so may the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you and give you peace. And I'm going to not close in worship tonight, though I appreciate our worship team tonight. And so I just want you to be able to just take a moment and be released tonight. And if you want to give somebody a hug or fellowship with somebody on the way out, but may the Lord bless your night. And God bless you guys. Coffee and cake in the multi-purpose room. Coffee, cake, donuts, and what else? And cheesecake. Okay, guys. So multi-purpose room, all kinds of stuff.